This morning's Old Testament reading found in the book of Leviticus and chapter 26. We shall read the chapter together, a little longer than our normal reading, but it's all of a whole, and therefore we'll read the chapter. Leviticus 26. Ye shall make you no idols, nor graven image, neither rear you up a standing image, neither shall ye set up any image of stone in your land to bow down unto it. For I am the Lord your God. Ye shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then I will give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit. And your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time, and ye shall eat your bread to the full, and dwell in your land safely. And I will give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid. And I will rid evil beasts out of the land, neither shall the sword go through your land. And ye shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword. And five of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight. And your enemies shall fall before you by the sword. For I will have respect unto you, and make you fruitful and multiply you, and establish my covenant with you. And ye shall eat old store, and bring forth the old because of the new. And I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you. And I will walk among you, and will be your God, and ye shall be my people. I am the Lord your God, which brought you forth out of the land of Egypt, that ye should not be their bondmen. And I have broken the bands of your yoke and made you go upright. But if ye will not hearken unto me and will not do all these commandments, and if ye shall despise my statutes, or if your soul abhor my judgments, so that ye will not do all my commandments, but that ye break my covenant, I also will do this unto you. I will even appoint over you terror, consumption, and the burning ache that shall consume the eyes and cause sorrow of heart, and ye shall sow your seed in vain, for your enemies shall eat it. And I will set my face against you, ye shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you. Ye shall flee when none pursueth you. And if ye will not yet for all this hearken unto me, then I will punish you seven times more for your sins. And I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron, and your earth as brass, and your strength shall be spent in vain, for your land shall not yield her increase. Neither shall the trees of the land yield their fruits. And if ye walk contrary unto me, and will not hearken unto me, I will bring seven times more plagues upon you according to your sins. I will also send wild beasts among you, which shall rob you of your children, and destroy your cattle, and make you few in number, and your highways shall be desolate. And if ye will not be reformed by me by these things, but will walk contrary unto me, then will I also walk contrary unto you, and will punish you yet seven times for your sins. And I will bring a sword upon you that shall avenge the quarrel of my covenant. And when ye are gathered together within your cities, I will send the pestilence among you, and ye shall be delivered into the hand of the enemy. And when I have broken the staff of your bread, 10 women shall bake your bread in one oven, and they shall deliver you your bread again by weight, and ye shall eat and not be satisfied. And if ye will not for all this hearken unto me, but walk contrary unto me, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury. And I, even I, will chastise you 7 times for your sins. And ye shall eat the flesh of your sons, and the flesh of your daughters shall ye eat. And I will destroy your high places, and cut down your images, and cast your carcasses upon the carcasses of your idols, and my soul shall abhor you. And I will make your cities waste, and bring your sanctuaries unto desolation. And I will not smell the savor of your sweet odors. And I will bring the land into desolation, and your enemies which dwell therein shall be astonished at it. And I will scatter you among the heathen, and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate, and your cities waste. Then shall the land enjoy her Sabbaths as long as it lieth desolate, and ye be in your enemies' land. Even then shall the land rest and enjoy her Sabbaths. As long as it lieth desolate, it shall rest, because it did not rest in your Sabbaths when ye dwelt upon it. And upon them that are left alive of you I will send a faintness into their hearts in the lands of their enemies, and the sound of a shaken leaf shall chase them, and they shall flee as fleeing from a sword, and they shall fall when none pursueth. And they shall fall one upon another, as it were, before a sword, when none pursueth, and ye shall have no power to stand before your enemies. And ye shall perish among the heathen, and the land of your enemies shall eat you up. And they that are left of you shall pine away in their iniquity in your enemies' lands, and also in the iniquities of their fathers shall they pine away with them. If they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass which they trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if then their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then will I remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. The land also shall be left of them, and shall enjoy her Sabbaths, while she lieth desolate without them, and they shall accept of the punishment of their iniquity, because, even because, they despised my judgments, and because their soul abhorred my statutes. And yet, for all that, when they be in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away, neither will I abhor them to destroy them utterly, and to break my covenant with them, for I am the Lord their God. And I will take for their sakes, remember thee, and I will for their sakes remember the covenant of their ancestors, whom I brought forth out of the land of Egypt, in the sight of the heathen, that I might be their God. I am the Lord. These are the statutes and judgments and laws which the Lord made between him and the children of Israel in Mount Sinai by the hand of Moses. Now, even in reading this chapter, we get some understanding of the solemn words which are spoken and which are written here. The form of the chapter appears to be as follows. There is an introduction in the first 2 verses. And in that introduction, God announces himself as the Lord, their God. And because of this, three things are required: that they worship God alone and do not bow down to idols. Secondly, that they keep the Sabbath days, verse 2. And thirdly, in the same verse, that they reverence the sanctuary by attending it at the appointed times and by doing within it what God has required of them. That being the introduction, the rest of the chapter falls into two parts. The first positive, the second negative. From verse 3 through to verse 13, the blessings are described, the blessings which will be given to obedience. And then from verse 14, more or less to the end of the chapter, the curses are described, curses which light upon disobedience. Now, there are words here which are found in the New Testament, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, words which speak of God walking with his people and communing with them. So there is relevance for the Christian in this chapter. But in order to see that, we will need perhaps to spiritualize some things, and we'll need to interpret it of spiritual blessing. What is the result of obedience, first of all? The blessings. Verse 3 begins, "If ye walk in my statutes and keep my commandments to do them." And then there's a list of the blessings which will follow. Some commentators believe that there are seven blessings listed here. It depends how you interpret some verses, but the seven blessings, first of all, there is the first, which is one of fruitfulness in verse 4. "I will give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase." It is true that when a people seek to submit themselves to God and do his will, that God is pleased to pour out his Spirit upon them and give them showers of blessing and cause them to know a fruitful spiritual life. The second blessing in verse 5 is plenty. "Your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time." Mention is made here of various seasons of the year. Normally there would be a period of waiting between one season and another, but such will be the fruitfulness given to the land of an obedient people, that one season shall flow to another, and that other season shall be followed quickly by another, and there will be fruitfulness all through the year. So the plenty here would seem to point to the full supply of all our needs, which God will give to his obedient people. Then in verse 5, at the end of the verse, there is a third blessing, safety. "You will dwell in your land safely." And God promises to his people that they will be resting in the Lord, and that he will look after them, and that they will be a people kept through all the changes of life, through the dangers, through the sorrows of life, they will be kept safe. Remember Christ's own words, "My peace I give unto you." This is followed in verse 6 with another blessing, peace. "I will give peace in the land, and ye shall lie down, and none shall make you afraid." The dwelling in safety in verse 5 seems to be outward. There will be no outward foe to threaten. But the peace of verse 6 seems to be inward. The peace of God in our hearts, which passeth all understanding. The next blessing is victory. In verse 7, "And ye shall chase your enemies, and they shall fall before you by the sword." And this is explained further in verse 8. Victory over all their foes. To God's people, he gives promise that if we follow him and keep with him, that he will give us victory over Satan, and he will give us victory for the truth as we seek to witness to the gospel in this world. The sixth blessing is his presence, mentioned in verse 11. "And I will set my tabernacle among you, and my soul shall not abhor you." God will reside with them, and God will reside with us if we are seeking to follow his word and be obedient to his precepts. And seventhly and lastly, there is a relationship mentioned in verse 12, "And I will walk among you, and will be your God, and ye shall be my people." Not only is the presence of God granted to obedience, but it's the presence of a God who is related to us, is close to us, and will deal familiarly with us. The presence of God could be granted to any people upon the face of the earth to defend them or to prosper them in some ways. But this is the presence of the Lord our God, the God who loves us, and the God who has promised good concerning us, and the God whose people we are. And therefore, that relationship will be very blessed indeed. A close relationship with God. Well, from verse 14, more or less to the end of the chapter, the curses are spoken, and it begins like this: "If ye will not hearken unto me, and will not do all these commandments, if ye despise them," and so on, "I will even appoint unto you." And then there is a list of the curses, the troubles, some of which are inward and some of which are outward. And possibly the worst of these curses or judgments, we would call them, and it's several times repeated, "If ye walk contrary to me," verse 27 and 28, "then I will walk contrary unto you." If you are against me and refuse my will and refuse to heed my word, then I will be against you. And I don't think there are any more terrible words than those in the Word of God. It's repeated again in verse 40 and 41. They have walked contrary unto me. I also have walked contrary unto them. For God to be working against us rather than for us, for God to be obstructing us and hindering us, for God to be bringing all our plans to be aborted, all our hopes to be dashed, that's a terrible, terrible thing. So blessing and the curse are set before us, blessings and cursings. If we take the Lord as our God and we follow him, it will result in a blessed life. Maybe not an easy one, but a blessed one. But if we depart from the living God and we go our own way rather than his way, the blessing will cease and God's judgments will overtake us even in this life. It's not for us to go through these curses this morning, and the hint of what they mean is understood by the blessings earlier in the chapter. But there's one lovely thing towards the end, that God says it may even result in exile. And of course it did when the Assyrians came in the land in the 8th century. And then when Nebuchadnezzar came into the land in the 6th century, there was deportation of many of the Israelites and the Judeans, and the latter languished in exile in Babylon for all those many years, 70 years. But then it says here that if their hearts be humbled, verse 41, and accept of the punishment of their iniquity, I will remember the covenant. I will not, verse 44, cast them away. I will not abhor them. I will not destroy them utterly. I am the Lord their God. So even if we have disobeyed and it's gone ill with us, and we've discovered the judgments of God in our life, still, if we humble ourselves and repent and turn to God, he will restore the blessings to us, fulfill the covenant to us, and appear to be our God in our own lives and in our own experiences. So it's a beautiful thing that at the end of the chapter, grace surfaces again and appears in all its beauty. And God is saying, just come back to me and confess your faults. Seek my forgiveness. These shall be granted to you, and the blessing shall be restored to you. Well, the Lord help us not only to trust in life, but also to obey. Now we'll sing from Psalm 107. I've chosen this because of the words found in Leviticus 26. The passage I'd like us to sing is perhaps too long to sing, so we'll sing a selection of verses here from Psalm 107, 32 to 38, and then 42 and 43. So it's Psalm 107, 32 to 38, and then 42 and 43. The tune is Southwell, which is 124. Psalm 107, then, beginning with verse 32.
Amen.
In the New Testament, we read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 7, and from verse 19. Luke's Gospel, chapter 7, from verse 19. And John, calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? When the men were come unto him, they said, John Baptist hath sent us unto thee, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? And in that same hour he cured many of their infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits, and unto many that were blind he gave sight. Then Jesus answering said unto them, Go your way, and tell John what things ye have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. And blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me. And when the messengers of John were departed, he began to speak unto the people concerning John. What went ye out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they which are gorgeously apparelled and live delicately are in king's courts. But what went ye out for to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and much more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. For I say unto you, among those that are born of women, there is not a greater prophet than John the Baptist. But he that is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And all the people that heard him and the publicans justified God, being baptized with the baptism of John. But the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the counsel of God against themselves, being not baptized of him. And the Lord said, Whereunto then shall I liken the men of this generation? And to what are they like? They are like unto children sitting in the marketplace and calling one to another and saying, We have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned to you, and ye have not wept. For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and ye say, He hath a devil. The Son of Man is come, eating and drinking, and ye say, Behold, a gluttonous man, and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of all her children. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him, weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And he said unto him, Thou hast rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, Seest thou this woman? I entered into thine house, thou gavest me no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, hath not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman hath anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. And to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. And he said unto her, Thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say within themselves, Who is this that forgiveth sins also? And he saith to the woman, Thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. In our prayers this morning, we will remember our brother Peter Bravery. He'll be undergoing an operation this Tuesday, a double bypass operation at Southampton Hospital. And we'll remember Peter and Susan and all the family in our prayers. Let us unite in prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, we do have love in our hearts for thee, love not brought about by effort of our own or by our own decision, but love which has been imparted to us. We love because thou hast first loved us. And oh, we long for grace to love thee as thou dost deserve to be loved. We find ourselves praying with the poet of old, Teach me, Lord, on earth to show by my love how much I owe. And we pray that that grace of love may be increased in us by the blessing of God, so that we love thee more than we love this world, more than we love anything else. We love thee above all things. We love thee most of all. Forgive us that in the past our love has been weak and faint. But again we say with another, Oh, for grace to love thee more. And we pray that our hearts may be taken up with the love of God, that we may esteem thee to be the best of all, that we may desire thee and seek thee with our spirits, and that we, finding thee, might delight in thee above others, that God would be the treasure of our hearts, the song of our lips, the hope of our lives, and that we may know what it is to know the Lord in a living way, in a way of heartfelt experience, and that our love, far from diminishing as time passes, might the more increase, and that we may love thee more and more. We pray for those today who need our prayers. We think of the many who in this church are unwell at the present time, and we pray that thou wouldst grant restoring good to them, that thou wouldst recover them from illness or sickness or sadness, whatever it may be, that soon many shall be back with us worshipping thee on the Sabbath day. We pray particularly for our brother Peter as he journeys tomorrow from Salisbury to Southampton. We pray that thou wouldst assure him of thy presence and love and care. And on Tuesday we pray that the surgeon and the team involved in this operation may be much helped, and that thou wouldst be gracious to our brother and give him peace in his heart, confidence in God, and bring him safely through this operation. May it be a great success, and may the problems which he suffered of late be known no more, and may he go on to live a full and active life under thy favor. So bless him and Sue today and all the family. We pray that thou wouldst draw near to them and give them the peace of knowing that through the love of God our Savior, all will be well. We do thank thee for the grace we have to pray for one another. We lovingly commend thee, Susan Richardson's father, there in Ireland, and we do pray that thou wouldst be with him and that thou wouldst restore his strength and grant that it may be good news from that quarter and that prayers will be answered for him. We pray for him and pray recovery and strength, and we pray that he may regain his natural abilities and that movement will be restored and that soon it will appear that the blessing of God is making him well again. Bless his dear wife as well, and we do remember all the family. Pray for him that his heart in the hour of his need may be turned to the Lord God, and that he would seek peace with thee and find peace in thee. Do bless him physically and spiritually, and with great love and concern we commit him unto thee. Remember our brother Roger Bolton, and we pray for him, thy good, all that thou wouldst move to end this period of weakness and sadness for him. We pray that soon may come the dawning of a better day, and that thou wouldst give Roger back to us as he once was, that his strength may be renewed like the eagles, and that he may revive under the blessing of the Almighty. We give thee thanks for so many wonderful tokens of love. We pause at this point to thank thee for the way thou dost financially sustain us as a church. And we've received the announcement again today of a month's offerings And we thank thee for the generosity of thy people. This support in matters material, indicating a spiritual desire that the church will be prospered. We thank thee for these further gifts, for the Grove House project. We marvel at this, at that deficiency which was there has practically been supplied. How good thou art. And we look back over the last 2 or 3 years. We stepped out in faith, relying upon God and his promise. We want to declare unto thee in the presence of all his people that God has been faithful and true, that the Lord God is good, and he giveth liberally to them that look unto him. We thank thee that thou dost support the work here, and we pray that thou wouldst continue to bless us in these ways, and especially in spiritual blessing, that there may be those who shall find the Lord in this place and serve him here. We remember those taking baptismal classes and those who will be starting them shortly. And we pray thee to bless these times and grant that soon the baptistry will be opened again with men and women confessing the name of the Lord Jesus, that name which is above every name. Do bless every evangelistic activity, every activity of outreach. May it be used, and may poor unbelieving sinners be reached and brought into the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ. Remember thy work in every place, and grant that where there is discouragement, there may be encouragement. Where there is decrease, that there may be increase. We pray that thy people may be made to look to thee, knowing that all good gifts come from above. Pour out the blessing of thy Spirit upon us, even as we read in the Old Testament scripture. He will pour showers upon the land. Oh, for showers poured upon this land and other lands also. We cry to thee for a work of God in our day, for God to bless us, because the blessing cannot come from men, nor from one another. It must come from thee. Oh, look then upon our weakened and enfeebled state, and restore us for thy name's sake. We ask our prayer through Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who loved us and died for us, and who has given us the ground on which to pray now. All we ask in his name. Amen. We'll sing now from Psalm 147. Psalm 147. The tune is Huddersfield 71. We're singing verses 1 to 7. Praise ye the Lord, for it is good. Praise to our God to sing. 147, verses 1 to 7.
Praise ye the
We turn yet again to the Epistle to the Colossians, chapter 4, and we shall be considering verses 5 and 6. Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. As we noted last week, the apostle is moving toward the end of this great epistle. And before he sends greetings to individuals, he comes to two exhortations, general exhortations. One is Godward, and that is concerning prayer in verses 2 and 3. Continue in prayer, with all praying also for us. And the other is manward, and it concerns conduct. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Let your speech be always with grace. Now, last Sabbath we looked at the Godward exhortation, continue in prayer. This morning we look at the manward exhortation, walk in wisdom toward them that are without. And you will see in what follows, in verse 5 and then in verse 6, that there are two matters which the apostle highlights. One is walking in the Christian life. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without. And the other, talking. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt. So I want to take just those two very simple headings this morning, walking and talking, as Christian people. First of all, walking. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without. Now, walk is a term used in Scripture for general behavior, particularly Christian behavior. In Romans chapter 4 and verse 12, Paul makes reference to those who walk in the faith of Abraham. In chapter 6 and verse 4, he speaks of walking in newness of life. In 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 7, he says, we walk by faith and not by sight. What this term means is that we are to take the Christian way. Or, if you like, interpreting it, to live the Christian life. One of the ways in which early Christians were described in the New Testament is people of the way. And that is because they followed the Lord Jesus Christ, who was the way. And as they sought to obey him and take him for their example, they were walking in the way, living their life according to their own faith, according to the word of God. Walking. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Now, the word does suggest a number of things to us, some of which I'll mention now. The first is, of course, if we are taking a new direction, then the Lord must have given us the life whereby we do this. After all, we are taking the way of God, and it's not possible for unregenerate men and women to do that. They that are in the flesh cannot please God. They can't live the Christian life. So what has God done to us? Well, he has imparted spiritual life to us. He has quickened us when we were dead in trespasses and sins. And he has raised us to a new life and experience. And it is this that enables us to live the life, to walk the walk, if you like. In Galatians chapter 2, Paul says, "Nevertheless, I live, but the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." He's living a different life. In order to do that, he has been inwardly blessed of the Lord, and it's all come from Jesus Christ. So God has given us new life, which enables us to live a new life altogether. The second thing to observe here is that the new way which we take is presented to us in the scriptures. It's called in Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 2, the way of the Lord. And there's one psalm which has a great deal to say of it, and that's Psalm 119. And there we read so often of the believer in the way. Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. So God has told us the way to take, and that way is revealed in Holy Scripture. When the Christian experiences new life, he enters into that way. Jesus spoke of it. "Enter in at the narrow gate," he said. Strive to enter in to the narrow way. And that's at the time of our conversion. We enter through the gate, and then we begin to walk the way of the Lord, a way which is called in Isaiah 35 the way of holiness. The third thing we ask here: walk in wisdom toward them that are without. Who leads us aright then in the way of God? Who directs us? And the answer to that must be the Holy Spirit of God. Now in Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 27, God promises this in his covenant. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And ye shall keep my judgments and do them. So that we won't stray, so that we won't turn to the right hand or to the left, so that we'll keep in the way everlasting, the Lord appoints a guide for us, as he appoints for all his children. They that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And the Spirit of God moves us to take God's way, to enter the gate, and to keep in that way which then opens before us. There are times when he seems to speak to us, times when he seeks to impart to us understanding. It's put like this in the scripture: thou shalt hear behind thee a voice saying, this is the way, walk ye in it, when ye turn to the right hand and when ye turn to the left. The Spirit of God has a peculiar ministry to us in that he gives us unease when we begin to depart, a lack of peace, a conviction of sin. But he leads us powerfully in the path that God would have us go. And he gives us an overwhelming contentment with that way and that route. And he blesses us along that pathway. So it's clear from what we are saying here: walk in wisdom toward them that are without, that Christianity is not merely a profession. It's not merely saying, well, I'm a Christian. But essentially, it is more than that. It's living a Christian life. And hence those words in Romans 6, to which I've already referred, that we should walk in newness of life. Now, why is it called newness of life? Because when the Christian begins to live, he is not living as once he did. It is apparent even to the ungodly, the unconverted, the unbelieving. It is apparent that this person has changed. And in consequence, their life has changed. You remember what was said of the Apostle Paul, recorded in Galatians 1:23, that such was God's grace in that man, that the Jews said, he now preacheth the faith he'd formerly destroyed. And that's because his eyes were on a different destination. He was walking with a different companion. He was on a different road. And the change was apparent. So, my friends, Christianity has got to affect our lives, you see. It's not just doctrinal affirmation. Well, we believe the gospel. We believe the Reformed faith. Of course, that's important. And you won't expect me to say anything other than that. But it is of paramount importance that we match faith with life. That we show that we are concerned about true religion and undefiled. And that we live out what we believe. We work out, to use Paul's words, our salvation in fear and trembling. To work out salvation does not mean that we save ourselves. It rather means to express in a godly life what has been wrought in us and believed by us. To work it out, make it visible. Demonstrate the Christian creed by living a Christian life. So Paul uses a term here, walk, which indicates not credence or acceptance, but more than that, it's a term that relates to activity and movement, living the life that we should live. Walk in wisdom. It's not easy. The Christian life is not easy. It's a narrow way. Sometimes it can be an uphill way. Sometimes a very difficult way, full of obstacles, hindrances, but we are nevertheless to walk. Whatever problems we encounter, whatever resistance we suffer, we must carry on walking, keeping to the way of God. We are not to be discouraged. The apostle says in Hebrews chapter 12, strengthen the weak knees. Meaning, don't think of falling. Don't think of giving up or fainting. Don't give up to pressure and fail. But continue. That's his word. Continue. And so we must. No man having put his hand to the plough and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Carry on ploughing. Go from one side of the field to the other. I can remember on the farm the days when we still used a hand plough. Of course, it's all done by tractors and machinery now, of a much more sophisticated kind than we had. But in those days, the horse would be out front. He would be carrying a very heavy plough behind him with a blade. And behind that plough would be the ploughman. Perhaps myself, perhaps my father or brother. The idea was to make sure that the blade got into the earth, and to keep the plough going in a straight line, straight furrow, right across the field. There's only one way to guarantee that, of course, and it was to look at something in the hedge before you. Keep your eyes upon that something and make towards it. And the Christian puts his hand to the plough, and he looks unto Jesus, the author and finisher of his faith. And as long as we've got our eyes upon him, living our life as in his sight, living our life one day to reach him, one day to be with him, we shall not make a crooked furrow and not spoil the ploughing of the field. But there must be a continuance. And that's why the scripture puts such emphasis upon that. Continue ye, the Lord Jesus said. We must endure to the end. we must go on, to use the words of Hebrews chapter 6. Well, how shall we manage to live out this Christian life? We're not very strong, any of us. Sometimes we have felt weakness, and under added pressures, we are on the brink of saying enough is enough. Better to stop than grind ourselves into the earth. Well, we have the help of the Lord Jesus. We read of the church in the Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verse 5. And she's represented there as coming up out of the wilderness. That's a hard thing. She's going uphill. She's been very wearied in the desert and in the dry wilderness. She's coming to an end of herself. But listen to this. Coming up out of the wilderness, leaning upon her beloved. That's where her strength is. In the Lord Jesus Christ. Without me, said he, ye can do nothing. And Paul would add, but I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. Walk then. Get on with life. Get on with being a Christian. And let others see that Christianity means so much to you that you've given your life to it. And that will mean progress. Progress. In Psalm 84, we read of those on the holy pilgrimage. They go from strength to strength until in Zion they appear before God. And we've got to make the similar progress, to go from strength to strength. Paul's words in the epistles is that ye may abound more and more. It's such a sad thing when a Christian fails lamentably before men. It stumbles the non-Christians to see a person who once professed, seemed to be very enthused, was committed. Now they're committed no more. It hardens the unbeliever into thinking, I told you so, there's nothing in it. It's all a myth and a fable and it's all a fantasy. He's discovered it. Having wasted several years of his life, he's come to realize it's just not worth it. So the unbeliever is hardened. But the unbeliever has nothing to say against the person who goes on and keeps to the way and will not be deflected from it or overcome in it, but who perseveres in the faith right to the end. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without. Do we have a companion? Well, I've mentioned it already in quoting from the Song of Solomon. The Lord's people lean upon their beloved. But of course, we have more express words with reference to Enoch, who walked with God. So however hard it is, and however you struggle with the Christian life, and however you're tempted sometimes to give up altogether, you have God walking with you. And he will lift you when you're fallen. He will strengthen your heart when you weaken. He will cause you to be courageous, of good courage, like Moses and like Joshua before us. He will sustain us. He will preserve us until the day that we are presented faultless before his presence. So we carry on. Let us go on. Paul writes to the Galatians and he says, looking back to their conversion, Galatians 5:7, he says, "Ye did run well. What hindered you?" They were hindered by false teaching. They left off the assemblies of God's people. They were stopped. Paul sees it as a great grief. Now we must hold on. He that is righteous, the book of Job, chapter 10, shall hold on his way. We must keep going, because at the end of the road, we shall have a sight of the Lord, and we shall be with him in our destination, which is the heavenly kingdom. This is to be the life we live, walking in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. There are two things said which are brought in to qualify the exhortation. We are to walk in wisdom, redeeming the time. Now, what exactly does that mean? Walk in wisdom. Well, first of all, it means that we are to walk in the light of God's revealed will. To put it as Paul puts it in Ephesians chapter 5, understanding what the will of the Lord is. And that means recourse to the scriptures, because there is the will of God revealed. So we walk in God's revealed way. That is what it is to walk in wisdom. Further, it means to walk with great respect for God, to walk in God's fear. That will stop you being foolish and frivolous. It will stop you behaving like a worldly man or woman. The fear of God. Proverbs 1:7. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. To have such a respect for God that the last thing you want to do is to displease him. The first thing you want to do is to please him. That is the fear of God. It means that you not only read the scriptures, but you keep up prayer. Let me remind you of that verse in James chapter 1. If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. Sometimes in life, we may reach a kind of crossroads or a road that turns off, and it looks to be the right way. We're not sure. Well, that's when we need divine assistance. And we cry to God for wisdom to make a right choice. And God will give that. He gives to all men liberally enough wisdom to make a true decision, to keep yourself in the way of God. Walk in wisdom. Avoid then the snares and the mistakes that others make. Wisely turn away from them. Maybe that you have friends who are always putting pressure on you to live like they live, to frequent the places that they frequent. But to do that would be to turn off from the main road. And it's often harmful, can even be fatal to the Christian to do that, to enter into some bypath meadow. No, my friends, in understanding be men. That's why Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man who sitteth not in the seat of the scornful. In other words, the man who doesn't keep company with ungodly people as his friends. Make friends of God's people. Let them be your associates, them your allies. And no fellowship with the people of God. And then, reading the word, knowing the fear of God, through prayer and faithfulness, you'll keep to the way. Redeeming the time. It's an enforcing word. You see, when it says walk in wisdom, it means that once you've become a Christian, your troubles are not altogether over. And it's not plain sailing and easy life now. We are the Lord's. You'll need wisdom. Your way will be sometimes confusing and perplexing. You'll need wisdom, and God will give that. But then he adds this, redeeming the time. What does he mean by that? It's literally buying up the time. Precious time can be lost. Time in which to serve the Lord, be devoted to him, discover his will for your life. Time can be lost with respect to these things. Time can be lost through idleness. Time can be lost through business, taking absolute priority over everything. Time can be lost through pleasure, frittered away on watching television or watching films or reading unhelpful books. What Paul is saying here is you have a short enough life. Don't let the years and the months and the days be lost. Redeem it. In other words, secure it. Make time for God and time for the Word of God to study it and for prayer to engage in it. Time to meet with God's people. Redeem the time. Don't let it be gone and know no more. Whatever price you have to pay, secure the time for God and for yourselves. Much of your time has already been lost. Christianity is not an hour a week on the Lord's Day. It's 7 days a week, 365 days a year and all the years of your life. Redeem the time. Perhaps the best way to do that is to live each day as if it were your last. And then you won't let it blow away. But you'll preserve the time. It'll cost you, but it'll be yours. If you give up your idleness, if you give up some of the pressures of business life intruding into your Christian life, if you give up your pleasures, which are pure distractions, it'll cost you, but it'll be worth it because you'll have a life to live for the glory of God, for the good of your souls. Walking. And then more briefly, talking. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. He turns from a general view of our behavior to one special aspect of it, our speech or our talk. Why? Because it's so important. By our speech, we communicate with others. We may communicate well, and we may not. It's not easy to keep a watch over what we say. One of the most difficult things in life is to control our lips, our mouth, and what proceeds through this organ. That is why James says in his epistle, the tongue is a member which no man can tame. It's not easy. And if you're not careful, it can be used to ill purposes and it can do great harm. Because out of the fountain there can come cursing and bitterness. So he says two things here about our speech. One is, let it be always with grace. I think in the first place that means be ready to speak of the gospel. Be prepared to tell to sinners all around what a dear Saviour you have found. Let your speech be taken up with the gospel. The second thing it means, I think, is this, that speak out of the abundance of grace in your own heart. What God has wrought within, he's planted faith and hope and love in your heart. Let your speech come out of these gifts and these benefits. Let it be always with grace. Let it be loving, tender-hearted, kind, tender, winsome. Let your speech be always with grace. Second thing is seasoned with salt. What you say, let it be such a thing as will reach the hearts of others. Don't trivialize, even when you're speaking of Christian things. The salt penetrates into that on which it falls. Let your speech be serious. Oh, there's a time to laugh. No one will deny it. But there's a time also to be grave and solemn and serious, sober-minded. Let your speech be savored with salt. Salt prevents corruption in meat. Don't let anything corrupt come out of your mouth. Anything that you think is a joke, but it's near the mark. And it just suggests immorality. Have nothing to do with that. Seasoned with salt. Salt gives a pleasant savor to the meal. Let your speech then be pleasant. Making life more helpful for someone else. Delivering a comforting word in season. Always with grace. Always. No exceptions. Not with grace until you flip or you lose your cool. And then it's otherwise, but always with grace. Christian consistency, seasoned with salt, every way good, ministering to the hearer, the one with whom you converse, so that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Living in a world where people have questions about God, questions about the purpose of life, questions about the end of life, questions about eternity. As Christians, we can address those questions, and we must answer those questions. But we're not here to argue, to get heated. We're not here to try to force people to our opinion. Let your speech be with grace, seasoned with salt. And then you will know what to say and how to say it. The psalmist says, O Lord, keep the door of my lips. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Be careful what you say. Be careful of the manner in which you say it. Be careful of the effect which your words bring. Walk as Christians. Talk as Christians. That will be the best witness and the best testimony. Nothing foul then. No swearing even under pressure. No blasphemy. Nothing that doesn't commend Christ and win others to faith in him. God help us so to walk and so to talk. Let us stand for prayer. Gracious God, we do thank thee for what we have been presented with in thy word this day. We confess our shortcomings. Oh, we're almost ashamed to look up to thee because we haven't walked as we should have done. We haven't talked as we should have done. We need more help to live the Christian life and to speak with gracious words like our Lord and Savior spoke. They marveled at the gracious words that proceeded from his mouth. Oh, give us to mind these things and to make us thereby better Christians. We ask thee now to bless us as we part. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.